I was in a band from about the age of 17. I've been drumming since the age of 12. I've kind of been in music since I was 5 years old. I grew up around music. My mum played piano and guitar. But I think it kind of really came to a head when I was 12 and I started drumming. Really started to enjoy that. Took it from there. Ended up in a studio just outside of Oxford, which was Radiohead's old studio. Did a bit of production there. And now I've got my own place. I initially got involved with Birdie's Baby kind of by accident. I was in a band back in 2010 and Mitch joined that band on piano. And that band then kind of broke up, stayed in touch with Mitch, did a solo album. And kind of went from there. Produced the last album, The Bullet Within. Played a few things on there as well as kind of extras. And yeah, then I was suckered into the band. Being the new drummer, what is it, drummer number four or something, is good. It's been quite challenging having to play some of the old drum parts, try and reimagine them to how I play them without changing them too much, but it's been good fun. I think I still always have a bit of a soft spot for Muse. Radiohead, obviously, I think that was my first real musical interest when I was a 14-year-old angsty teenager. Foo Fighters, Rage Against the Machine, System of a Down, Everybody's Guilty Pleasure and Paramore. I think I will try and turn Birdie's Baby into the next Paramore, if I'm honest. That's my life's goal. I'd say it's the craziest band I've been in. I've been in quite a few bands. It's weird, it's kind of like the most organised chaos ever, really. It's like all the gigs are meticulously planned, everything, you know, we book in these recording sessions and their set times. And you turn up to the gigs on time, you do your sound check on time, and then as the night goes on and the beers start flowing, it just gets a little bit more chaotic and crazy, but still professional, you know, we get on stage, you do a thing, and then it just goes mental afterwards, so what can I say? I think whenever you bring new members to a band, it always changes the musical direction a little bit. I mean, you just have to listen to the past Birdie's Baby records before I was in the band. I think where The Bullet Within was with the guitar layers and the synth layers and all of these huge strings arrangements, I think there's going to be a lot more of that to come. The fourth album is on its way. We have started recording. Those of you that like follow us on Facebook and Snapchat and Instagram will have seen some sneaky little pictures of some drums happening and maybe some guitars as well. It's getting there. It's a long process to record an album, but it's a good fun process. So, yeah. I think the goal with Birdie's Baby is to have as many people listening to our music, just listening to the rubbish that we have to say and the chaos that we have to produce for your ears. I think my favourite track to play live on stage is Hands of Orlac. The drums are great. I haven't really changed them much from the album version other than putting in a few more crashes and a few more huge snare hits. I just love the ending of that song. Get to hit everything as hard as possible, even in the tiniest of venues, and they can't do nothing about it. Yeah, I think hanging out as a band is it's fun. It's fun. I mean, when we hang out at the studio, we write quite a lot. And we jam out ideas. I get told to shut up because my drums are too loud. Gary inevitably plays a wrong note. Mitch turns around and slaps him in the face. Hannah just sits there in the corner crying a lot. So yeah, all in all, it's a good experience to hang out with the band. It's great. Have a few beers, have a bit of a fight, some songs come out, and here's an album. Yeah, so you'll see a lot more of Gary on guitar, I think. More experimentation with synths and effects, even on violin. Even live vocal effects as well. I think it's going to just add another edge to what's been going on already. There'll be more huge strings arrangements, huge choral things going on, full choirs, full orchestras, the lot. So yeah, it's going to be huge and epic next album.
played guitar for years, and I thought, this is actually alright. I could be in a band, I could do this. So, that's what I went to do. I studied in Scotland for a couple of years, and then I thought, fuck this, I'm going somewhere else. So I ended up in Brighton and all places. Met this delectable stranger called Mitch. Who I thought was called Elizabeth. I called her Elizabeth for a week. Called Liz. It's actually Mish. Yeah, she's alright.
There you go.
Farms, really?
Yeah, really.
I do look pretty.
Yeah, she asked me for guitar lessons, so I taught her guitar. She asked me to do any bass players. So yeah, I could play it. Started playing gigs, and 3 albums later, right, I started writing for a 4th album. And it's going to continue like that. When I moved here, like, what I was listening to was mostly prog rock. Mostly 70s prog rock. And that was what I imagined myself getting into, big wanky guitar solos, and just some of that genre. Probably a metal band, probably progressive metal. But then I got into Dudley's Baby, and yes, they will be progressive. They will be more and more progressive, and more rock. That is going to happen. I don't know what the next album is going to be called. Probably it's going to have my face on the cover. My name is the album. Yeah, it'll just be like a, I don't know, Gary Eats Baby. Yeah, that's what it'll be called. Diversity Queen's music. Ridiculous. They could be a heavy rock band, they could do piano ballads, they could do some pretty trip-type music, they could do some really bad music, they've got a lot of bad albums, unfortunately. Which I'd like to add, but it's maybe we'll never have. They do take a lot from Muse and Queen, and the reason for that is because they're amazing. So. But I'm on stage, all I've got to do is walk in with the drummer, and speak. It's as good as it gets. There's been a couple of drummers, there's been Charlie, there's been Carter, Philippa. Now we've got Forbes.
Hang me if you're dry, you fucking baldy prick.
4 decent drummers. And I've got to play bass to their drums. So yeah. Yeah, life is good. I've come down the bass lines to play on stage. Like, Anchor's quite technical. It's quite hard to play. And I knew if I was learning bass and I heard that as a bass sound, I'd be like, ooh, that's tasty. And it is tasty, it's a really tasty bass line. I think that's what makes it a good band. As long as the tunes are good as well. If the tunes are there and all the musicians are solid, then what's to not like? That's maybe narcissistic, but what I do like is when the crowd reacts when you finish a song. So sometimes you know you've played well, you know everything about it has just been perfect. There's not an absolute note missed. And the crowd just reacts instantly. You get the as soon as you hear the last note, it's just a and everybody gets in, just like standing, it's like, yeah. So I don't know, maybe a secret kind of praise. Maybe most musicians do, a secret kind of praise. The want to be appreciated. I suppose that is kind of a human thing. But when it comes from strangers when you're on stage, that's kind of special. That's what makes it. Whether it's 20 people, whether it's like, I don't know, 500, 800, 1,000 people, regardless. When you know you're up there and you hear like, people really appreciate what you're doing, it's like, yes, it's what I do. And then when it comes down to the basic level, when you're sitting practicing the songs on your own and you're formulating the songs, you're coming up with your own parts, you're trying to improve them, it's what makes it all worth it. It makes all that time just put into all that effort and practice you're putting in, all that tears and sweat, like, put into it. When you're up there on stage and people like it and people just, you can tell they really love it, you're just like, yes, yes. I think maybe musicians are, I'm trying to think of the correct term, I wouldn't say self-centred, I would say fragile people. I mean, they get that level of praise, it's like, yes. Maybe deep down as children, they always want that, maybe they never got that praise from their parents as kids. It's like, Daddy, did I do well? So I can just hold you flat. So you get on stage and it's like, yes, yes. I think there's deep-seated issues with every musician.
Hey,
wasn't much to look at, but words the spider spun. The girls around in circles, one by one by one. It's a bad life you chose to lead, and the same stars hang over me like a sad child. No one wants to leave, but we left you in the till your hands are bound and you're no threat to be around. It's a bad life you chose to lead, and the same Christ hangs over me. You're like a sad child.
Since I was very, very little, and I tried to be a classical concert violinist, and then I got seduced by rock and roll. My earliest influences were obviously classical musicians, in particular violinists. Then I got into metal when I was a teenager, a lot of gothic music, and then rock and roll. Being in Bennett's Baby is a lot of fun, and yeah, I think a lot more fun is gonna come. I front my own band, Hannah Piranha, which is a band quite similar to Bernie's Baby in ethos and, I suppose, sound-wise. And that's how I know Mishka, and I've shared a few stages with her and Bernie's Baby in the past. I think being in a band is a calling, it's a vocation, and when you meet like-minded people who have a professional attitude and also just a real love of music, then it's a real winner. And that's what I found in Bernie's Baby.
Hi.
Fuck off! my biggest influences are probably kind of really badass female rock chicks. In particular, Patti Smith. I saw her live a few years ago, and the thing I'll always remember from that performance is when she came out on stage and just walked from one side of the stage to the other, like, this is my instrument, I own this. One of the things I like about the band and the reasons I joined it were that I do really like the niche kind of dark cabaret sound and the kind of classical influences. I see a heading in a far more, a bit of a heavier direction, I think. More rock and roll, bigger sound in general, just heavier instrumentation, while still retaining that signature sound that the band has.
Do you think he's the most beautiful man in the world?
Oh, I do as well, I know.
Oh my god,
shine.
There he is!
He's got a bit shiny and modest now, so I'm just going to go tight.
I think songwriting's a real vocation as well, and I think that it serves a lot of purposes. I think that it's very therapeutic, and if you're a songwriter, you do it too, because you can't really communicate in any other way, I think. And it's really cool to be in a separate band from just what I'm doing myself, and to be able to collaborate, to be able to see what another songwriter, how their thought processes work, you know, how they write. That's really exciting. If I had to listen to one song only for the rest of my life, it would probably be I'm Only Happy When It Rains by Garbage. I don't like to party, I can't stand parties. I just like to sit in my room in the dark by myself and just think about things. But it's maybe a mum word. Halloween.
Honey peepee. Oh. Where are you?
Don't.
That's a smile, that's a smile.
I'm not afraid to die.
left with the cold and the dark and the numbership. I'm sympathetic, I should know I meant it. I pointlessly argue my case as defendant. Headache staring, today tearing, earthquake bearing. How could she go?
When I first grew up was singing hymns in church, playing the piano in church, and generally that's where I learned how to sing and how to play the piano. After that I would listen to my dad's records. He had a really eclectic collection of classical music, opera, rock, pop, world music, so I was really obsessed with that for quite a while. And then when I was a bit older, when I was a teenager, I discovered rock bands like Muse, Placebo, System of a Down, Radiohead, loads of bands that I'm still really into now. And that was really the moment when I realised I wanted to start a band and be a musician, much to the disappointment of my parents. Before I go on stage, it's kind of... it used to be really nerve-wracking. I still do get nervous sometimes, but for me it's like an anticipation of something. You know, you get really tingly and you get butterflies, but it's a really good feeling as well. And then the moment you go on stage, that all just kind of goes away, and then you're just in this moment. It's really cool. It's the most fun I think you could possibly have as a musician, is being on stage and just feeding off the energy in the crowd and the energy from the music. There's nothing like it. I'm totally addicted to it. It's brilliant. For me, a song begins when I get a line in my head and it just goes round and round and round. I'll go to sleep thinking about it and I'll wake up in the morning and it's still there, and it basically just won't leave me alone until I sit down at the piano and I properly write it out. This process can go on for weeks or months. It's generally quite a long process. It has to be a really good song to stick around in my head before I'll actually kind of give it the space to come out and become an actual song. But usually I'll get one line, I'll get like a hook in my head, and it'll just all stem from that. So it's pretty random, I can't really explain it. I think it's quite exciting to write about something that only you know what it's truly about. It makes the song more interesting, I think, because then it can mean something else to a different person. I know that I've listened to songs and thought, oh, for me that means this, whereas, you know, it could really mean anything. But if it means something to you and it makes you feel strongly, then that's kind of a song that served its purpose. But I definitely like to write in poetry. I think it's a good way of expressing yourself, expressing something that's going on without really having to be blatant about it. So it's a good way of releasing something.
He wasn't much to look at, but words the spider spun. The girls around in circles, one by one by one.
Making videos is really, really fun. I guess I'm just like trying to live out all my fantasies in the form of a music video. I don't know. I think when I write a song, I always have a picture of what the music video should be like as well. So it's for this particular band, for Bird Eats Baby, it's such a visual band anyway. I mean, the lyrics are really visual. When we're on stage, it's quite a visual thing as well. So the music video is just a really big deal for us ever since the first music video that we made. It's just another way of us expressing that art form. So I guess that's why we're really into our music videos, and also it's really fun to dress up and act a bit crazy. We get some funny looks when we're making the videos.
Yeah, we're filming the music video for My Arms All Open Wide. We're looking very dapper, yes. Don't you think? I mean, look at our outfits.
Yes.
It's very good, very good. Yes. We're in this beautiful bit bridge in somewhere in Worthing, or what was it called?
No, I'm in Pulborough.
It's happening, and it's all happening in Pulborough. The Bird Eats Baby music video is happening in Pulborough. So yeah, it's beautiful. This is the bridge that I'm going to and the guy's going to try and save me, but
thank God.
But he was too busy drinking beer instead.
Nightmare. Oh, fucking hell, man. You might be in stylist.
No, you're meant to look ruffled because you've been running.
Oh, right,
so
okay.
That's why.
Oh, okay.
Just yeah, look. If you just do a little bit of that, it's fine.
Okay.
Oh, beautiful. So good.
I think Bird Eats Baby will always be my number one project. It's really fun to express myself in different ways, but I've never gotten the same feeling out of it. I think for me, Bird Eats Baby combines all of the elements of music that I love. It's got the classical element to it, you know, the piano that I'm really obsessed with. It's got the violin, so it's got this really kind of classical core, but then it's really heavy, really rock, and really dark, which is all the music that I love, have these three elements to it. So I think I just keep coming back to it because for me it's the most exciting music that I feel I've made as a project. I think it has changed a lot over the years, but I think the music has changed as well. So I wouldn't say that, you know, the lineup has changed and that's been the only thing that's changed with the band. I think the sound has changed so much. If you listen to the first few songs that we put out compared to the stuff that we're making now, it's a really quite a big progression. You know, the band has completely evolved from one sound to another. So I think it's kind of natural that the lineup has changed, and every time it has, the music has then gone into a different direction as well. I think, you know, we don't want to be a one-trick pony, and we want to always be pushing the boundaries of what we're doing musically. The name Bird Eats Baby came from, it's a good question. We've told a lot of stories about it, but the actual truth about the band name is when I was about 17 or 18, I had a really bad year where I just couldn't sleep. I had terrible insomnia. I would not be able to sleep until say 4 or 5 in the morning, and then I'd have to get up for school at 7. So I was having like 2 or 3 hours a night, and then I'd be exhausted all day and then get home. And then as soon as it got to like 10 or 11 at night, I'd just be wide awake again. So I was quite creative during this time. So I was writing a lot of songs because I think my head was just in a different place, and I was so tired all the time that I kept like going into sort of this dream world and then coming back out of it. But eventually I went to the doctors and they gave me these really strong sleeping pills, and they gave me nightmares. Just every time I went to sleep, I had these horrific nightmares where I wasn't sure if I was awake or asleep. And during that time, I wrote a lot of really dark music. I think that's where the band kind of formed. And out of one of those nightmares, I got the band name Bird Eats Baby. I just remember thinking, like, that's the name for this band. So yeah, it definitely came from like a nightmare I had. Hammers was definitely like a nautically themed album, a lot of water imagery for it. I didn't really mean to do it, it just so happened that all the songs that I was writing at that time reflected that. So yeah, I guess it just comes, again, a lot of things that I write, they all come from dreams that I have. I wake up in the morning and I'll think, well, that was a crazy dream, and then I'll start writing it down, and then when I'm next at the piano, it'll start to come into the song.
Pages and pages and pages of poetry, I am not doing so well. Teach me the Bible, the scriptures, disciples, and baby, teach me how to spell.
I don't really have a relationship with religion now. I wouldn't say that I'm not a spiritual person, but I don't know how it makes me feel now. I think it's not something that made me happy when I was a child, so I can't say that it's had a massively positive influence in my life, but it's definitely something that has influenced me, and I'm kind of grateful that I've got that. It's yeah.
Denied.
Music definitely exists for me in my head, because it's always in my head. That's why I listen to music, because it turns the other music off in my head. So I'm mental. There's always a song going on, whether it's someone else's song or a song that I'm writing. It never switches off. I think that's part of the problem. Part of my problem is my head never switches off. After a gig, it's really fun. It's kind of like an instant relief, because you know that you've done your thing. There's quite a lot of partying, I have to say, in this particular band.
I feel old.
I'm 35 old. Oh, gosh,
yeah.
You're
one. 35 old when you married a child.
Go ahead, mate. I don't think...
10 to Hicks is great fun, mainly because I don't have to play any complicated piano parts, so I get to just rock out and have fun. I really like playing I Always Hang Myself on the Same Rope, just because it's a bit of a punk rock song, so it's really fun, and I know it so well that my fingers are just falling in the right place, and I don't have to think about it at all, so it's really, really fun. And of course The Trouble is really fun to play live as well, even though I've played that song 100 million times. I like Incitatus as well, just because it's so mental, so I'm kind of proud that I've written a song that's that mental. I write songs because I can't do anything else. I can't focus on anything else except music. Even if I've got a task to do that's something else in the day, I just get distracted and start writing songs. I've just always done it from when I was little. I've always had these little lyric books. I'm obsessed with buying new notebooks, and then I just fill them with all these crazy writings. But I guess I write songs because I feel compelled to. I don't have a reason for it, it just happens. They write themselves. Shows that we've done in London, My Black Heart was a really great gig. That was really, really fun. The lineup that we have right now is like probably my favourite lineup, so I'm really chuffed with it. So the gigs that we're doing right now, I'm really excited about as well. Oh, my favourite drink is gin through and through. It's just beautiful. You can't beat gin. It just makes me happy.
Breadsticks are basically like, this is nothing. There's nothing inside here. You know, like it's pretending to be food. It's not food.
Made a dream.
Walrus tusks. Walrus tusks. Fucking hell.
The candy floss of the bread.
Do the walrus tusks. Come on.
Do it.
I've seen this.
I'm a vampire.
Yes.
I've been big. Listen, I'll fucking show you
fucking
vampire. Fuck off.
Being in a band, it's like being in a family. It's nice, actually. Like, we all get on really, really well, so it's nice. I know there are other bands there that don't get along so well, so it is really, really good that we're all really good friends and we look out for each other. It's really fun. It can be really hard. There's a lot of ups and downs, especially when you're touring. You can have an amazing show and then the next day just have the worst show ever, or just something go wrong.
So it is definitely like a roller coaster, but I think that keeps it exciting. Like, we've got a lot of good stories to tell. You know, when I look back at being in Birdie's Baby for this long, I've definitely got more good memories than bad. But yeah, it is strange. You're kind of jumbled in together, mostly in the back of a van. It's not very glamorous, I'll just say that. I'm a big Placebo fan, the early songs, so I guess Every You and Every Me is just an amazing song. Like, lyrically, it's just perfect, it's so clever, it's really catchy. That's just a brilliant song. That's the song that I wish I'd written, definitely. I first met Gary at university. We were on the same course, and both quite shy and introverted. Not anymore. and I think I asked him for bass lessons or something, I can't remember. Or anyway, I asked him to play bass on this song that I was writing that was with the first line of Birdie's Baby, and he did. And yeah, we just got on really well. He was always really nice, really easy to get on with, and musically we agreed on quite a lot of things. And yeah, we just become really good friends over the years. So yeah, that's the me and Gary story. Forbes, I worked with Forbes first of all on a solo record that I did in 2013. And we've got a really good musical connection. We love the same bands, almost identical, same bands that we love. And he's an amazing producer. So after working with him on the solo record, it was inevitable that we were going to work on the Birdie's Baby record. And then after that, it was inevitable that he was just going to join the band. It kind of just happened as like a gradual thing, but you know, couldn't have asked for a better drummer. And the fact that he produces our music as well is just even better. And you know, he's all right as well. Hannah's really cool. Yeah, I never thought she'd join our band. I mean, she's got her own project, Hannah Piranha, which is like this amazing epic kind of violin project that she sings in. So yeah, we're really lucky that I just asked her out of the blue when we knew that our previous violinist was leaving. And I never thought she'd say yes, but it's actually worked out really, really well. Our bands play together quite a lot. The music's quite compatible and we get on really, really well. And as a four piece, we're all really good friends. So like I said, I think it's a really good lineup for this time. On Feast and Hammers, there's a song called Double Nine that I wrote out of a really traumatic time in my life. And I wrote it because I needed to get that emotion out, and I couldn't really talk to anyone about what was going on. So I just poured it into this song. So it's probably like the most angry song I've ever written. It's really about the fact that when traumatic things do happen to you, in a way, they end up making you who you are, so you should almost be happy that they've happened, even though at the time it's a really terrible thing that you go through. It ends up making you stronger. So that song was a really hard song to write out, but when I was playing it, and I don't really ever play it anymore, which is a shame, but I really needed to write that song and to get it out that way. And so for me, that was one of the hardest songs to write. I found it difficult to even practice it and sing the lyrics, but it came out of that. So. Me and Gary have written quite a few songs together. We wrote Tenterhooks together, which is really fun because I think it doesn't sound like any of our other songs. It was a complete mashup and really heavy. That's when we started to write kind of a bit more heavier music. But yeah, that's definitely got Gary's stamp on it. The song My Arms Will Open Wide, it's right at the end of the Bullet album. That song is probably, if I'm being brutally honest, it's about suicide. It's about giving up on everything and knowing that you're going to give up on everything, about things coming to an end and not really sure about what you're going to do. So that's, it's kind of sad, but that's what it's about, honestly.
Silence is a song about being trapped in a cage without a voice, and not being able to express anything, really, being completely ignored, shut out. I actually wrote it because I feel quite strongly about animal rights. Just gonna put that out there. And I just think that, you know, it would be horrific to be in a situation where you can express anything, you know, where you just have your rights taken away, really. So I wrote that song out of anger as to how animals are treated in this world and how we view them as humans in general. It's just awful. So I kind of wrote that song as an expression of that. Maybe some people wouldn't understand that, but for me, it's really personal. I never wanted anything but this, so don't let me down. Let me have what I want just once. It's enough to pick me up, kick me out, steal back the vanity. Now we are kept buried like dead. I never wanted anything but this, but I could try. Silence is a master. The Flock is our fan base. They are people who know the band. Most of them are friends of the band as well. I know quite a lot of them on a personal level. They're people that we've met along the way when we've been touring. We've stayed in their houses. They come to our gigs. They support us. They're just this crazy bunch of amazing people spread all across the world that love our music. It's amazing. To be honest, I think like the music that we create is pretty weird, so sometimes that does attract weirdness, but I kind of like weirdness, so I sometimes think, you know, it just adds to the experience of being in a band. There's no such thing as too dark. Which, yeah, I mean, Jesus, we did a video where we like bashed our heads in with hammers in the woods and got eaten by our fans. I don't think you can get much darker than that, so. But we'll try. We'll keep trying. Next for Verdict's Baby is just complete and utter world domination. You know, we want to be in everyone's houses. You know. No, we're just going to carry on writing music and sharing it with our flock. We've got two new singles coming out later this year that are quite different to our normal stuff. It's like another progression. And then next year we're going to put out an album. We've actually got a really cool idea to release a song every single month next year with an accompanying music video, and the whole thing should make up like a progressive story. So there's going to be a lot of planning required. We've got a lot of work to do, but that's just the way I like it. I don't ever want to stop. So yeah, lots of things on the cards. Hopefully a tour out in America. We haven't been there for a couple of years now, and that's not right. So we're going to try and do that. And yeah, just carry on making music.
You laid out your life in selections of photographs hung up to dry. Shoot through the middle and gather your points by protecting yourself from another bad choice. No one will care if you put out that light. You built an army, but they would not fight. So then speechless and void, you're just a memory stuck in the mirror with no exit strategy. Well, you should move on and make a life of your own. Get happily married and live in a home. But you can't sit still and you're certain it's true. There's just too many them and just not enough you. You're a rat in a cage, you're a bull in a china shop. To center stage for the world just to spit you up. I say let's chill.
Yeah.
anything different or anything new. You and me both with a bullet within. We're just playing a game that nobody can win. So I'll burn all my promises, never agree to become what I hate and then hate what I see. I'm as empty as blood of the air that I breathe.
There must be